So when Clement Price and Giles Wright began the Marion Thompson Wright Lecture Series back in 1981, they of course, obviously wanted to study and honor the past, but I think they also wanted to do this with an eye steadfastly on the present, so that we might better understand it and change it, so that Black History Month might also be Black Futures Month. I don't need to recite to you the incidents that, since the killing of Trayvon Martin and the formation of Black Lives Matter, of the Black Lives Matter movement, have brought renewed and more widespread and more critical attention to matters of law enforcement, the judicial system, and incarceration. And crucially, the disproportionate violence, physical, cultural, economic, political, waged by this criminal justice system on people and communities of color. MTW's strength, and one of its great values in my mind, has always been that it provides the opportunity to see how recent events have been created by a much longer history, that simply put, we can better understand where we are by knowing where we came from. So this year, we searched sort of high and low for a title for this year's entry. One of the many times that we dearly missed Professor Price's seemingly bottomless well of well-turned phrases and perfect quotations. But after a while and after much searching, we found an old work song called "I Wonder What's the Matter," recorded by Alan Lomax for the Library of Congress in the early 1930s at a prison in East Texas. No doubt the song goes back much further than that, but that's the recording we found. And the refrain in this recording, sung by a man named Lightnin' Washington and his backup singers, goes, "Well, I wonder what's the matter with my long time here." And the phrase evoked, we thought, not only the experience of incarceration, perhaps especially today, when the emphasis has fallen so firmly on incapacitation rather than, say, rehabilitation, and especially today, this Saturday, the day after Albert Woodfox, who likely spent more time in solitary confinement than any other person in American history, was released from the Louisiana State Penitentiary at Angola just yesterday. But it also speaks, sure. But it speaks also to the way these issues of prisons and policing, of criminalization and incarceration, have plagued our nation for so long. The scholarship offered today certainly speaks to these issues' deep roots in American history, our culture, and our political and economic systems. And so if you wonder, like Lightnin' Washington, what's the matter with our nation's long time here, there will be much to learn today. From a history of struggle here in Newark, covered by this afternoon's panel discussion, to the criminalization of urban blackness at the turn of the 20th century in Professor Khalil Muhammad's work, to the ways that putting mass incarceration at the center of our narratives of the American century allows us to see new aspects of inequality and underappreciated fights against it in Professor Heather Ann Thompson's writing, to finally this year's Marion Thompson Wright Lecturer's deep dive into California's political economy and the rise of the prison industrial complex. These thinkers have opened up new vistas of research and action. And there are a few people who synthesize these vistas as creatively, as sort of breathtakingly, I think, as Professor Ruth Wilson Gilmore. And it's easy enough to tell you that she's a professor of geography in the program in Earth and Environmental Sciences at the CUNY Graduate Center and director of its Center for Place, Culture, and Politics. But her work and career sort of defy these easy academic narratives, you know, the degrees earned here and there, the teaching positions held at various schools, although I suppose I'd be remiss not to mention that she did her PhD work at Rutgers University. And I bet I'm picking up the story a bit late here when I say she's been a lecturer, writer, and activist on issues of race, violence, and criminal justice since at least the early 1990s, I'm sure much longer than that, when she was based in eastern Los Angeles County. As she writes in her stunning Golden Gulag, Prisons, Surplus, Crisis, and Opposition in Globalizing California, the questions and analysis driving her research came from the work encountered in everyday activism on the ground. Much of that activism came with Mothers Reclaiming Our Children, or Mothers Rock, an LA organization formed in 1992 to combat the increasingly violent claims the carceral state had been making on young African Americans. Later that decade, Gilmore was a member of the collective that formed Critical Resistance, a grassroots organization dedicated to the abolition of the prison industrial complex. And I hope she'll forgive me if I skip rather quickly across, yes, skip, across a bunch of brilliant essays, untold numbers of lectures, to get back to Golden Gulag, which is perhaps the grand culmination to date of those questions and that analysis that she'd been building across the years. So published in 2007 by the University of California Press, the book was quickly dubbed the first must-read book of the 21st century by the San Francisco Chronicle. The following year, it won the American Studies Association's Laura Romero First Book Prize and takes readers on a grand tour of California history, economics, and politics to explain the boom in prison construction and incarceration in the closing decades of the 20th century. It showcases Professor Gilmore's skills, her experience, her knowledge, not only as a scholar of mass incarceration, but also as a scholar of activism, of the struggle against mass incarceration. She served as the president of the American Studies Association in 2010-2011, and in 2012, the ASA awarded her its inaugural Angela Davis Prize for Public Scholarship. Today, her lecture is entitled Too Soon for Sorry. It's an honor to introduce her to you. So please join me in welcoming this year's Marion Thompson Wright Lecturer, Professor Ruth Wilson Gilmore.
Beautiful. All right, good morning. Woo. Woo, how's everybody doing today? This is my first time giving a lecture at my alma mater, Rutgers. The last lecture I gave was my dissertation defense. I was a lot more nervous that time. But I am humbled this time to be here with all of you on this beautiful day, to join my good close colleagues, Heather Thompson and Khalil Muhammad, in sharing our research and excitement and commitments with you, and to learn this afternoon from the panel roundtable discussion about what is going on here in Newark and in New Jersey. I want to thank Mark Krasovic and Marisa Pearson and everybody else who played any part, large or small, in my invitation and in welcoming us all here, feeding us, making sure that we're happy and well. I live over in New York now, as Mark said. I teach at the Graduate Center of CUNY, and it's really quite amazing to me how close I live as the crow flies and how infrequently I make it to this side other than to keep going to the airport. All right, so here we go. I'm going to talk my talk, not read it, but every so often I will have to find my way because it's the way it works. These people, do you recognize them? All right, on the left is, there is a caption. On the right is, no. Come on. Who that? Ooh, silence. Cabral. Muito bem. Cabral. Okay. So, I'm starting with Harriet Tubman and Amilcar Cabral because these are two people who, in the history of the Black liberation struggle, for Tubman on this side of the Atlantic, for Cabral on the other side of the Atlantic, developed their fundamental knowledge of what to do and how to do it by walking the land. Harriet Tubman, as you know, was a great leader of, indeed an innovator of, what we've come to call the Underground Railroad. She said, I once met a man who spent 25 years in prison. During those years, he dreamed of going home. He dreamed of the old folks. He dreamed of his community. And eventually, the time came for him to go home. And he left prison, and he went back to the old home place. But his house was no longer there. His family was no longer there. There was nobody who knew his name, and nobody to welcome him back to the land of freedom. So it was with me, she said. I had finally, after escaping from that place in Maryland, made the movement, found my way to freedom, and there was no one to welcome me to that land. After all, she said, wasn't my home still back in the quarters with the old folks and my brothers and sisters and cousins and the other people in that community? And so she said, I committed that I would show them a way to freedom. I would make a home for them. And so she did. She was an armed robber, thief, and spy. She is my hero. It's not a broom she's holding, it's a rifle. So one of the most cited lines of Harriet Tubman is, I freed 1,000 people, and if I could have freed more if they had known they were slaves. Many people take that to be a rather facile put down on Tubman's part of the people she encountered in her travels across the land of unfreedom. I don't think it is. I think that she was recognizing that torn ambivalence that she expressed when she said, I finally got there, but my home was still there. So people who did not realize they were, recognize they were slaves were not insensitive to their unfreedom, but they were unwilling to give up their families, their communities, their lives for this abstract thing which they would do alone, as prisoners did and do, coming home to communities that do not welcome them back to the land of freedom. So this thought of Tubman is a way that I guide myself through my work, thinking about the land and thinking about how people think about themselves in the land. Cabral, similarly, he was born in Portuguese West Africa, grew up between Guinea-Bissau and Cabo Verde. Anybody here Cabo Verde? Guinea-Bissau? Portugal? Bom dia. And as the Portuguese Empire, under the dictatorship of Salazar, similar to all other imperial forces, like the United States today, was wont to do in Cabral's childhood, he was identified as a bright young man who could become a very effective manager of resources in Guinea-Bissau and Cabo Verde for the Portuguese state. So this young man had every educational opportunity, was groomed in the mission schools in Guinea-Bissau, and eventually went to Lisbon to do a doctoral degree in agronomy, soil science, in order to help the Portuguese state figure out the best ways to use the land, the agricultural resources of Guinea-Bissau. In order for him to do that kind of advisement for the colonizer, Cabral, like Tubman, had to walk the land. He traveled every square inch of Guinea-Bissau as he was becoming and developing his revolutionary consciousness. He talked to people. He understood as best he could what their concerns were, what their hopes were, what their fears were. And he also saw, as Tubman saw, the extent to which a certain kind of consciousness could come into being if only people had a chance to develop it. So, having completed his agronomy degree, and started his career as an agronomist for the Portuguese Agricultural Commission, he suddenly disappeared from Lisbon, turned up in Paris, which was a central place for revolutionaries from around the world, developed his understanding of anti-capitalist, anti-colonial, anti-racist struggle, and became a member of the party, the African Party for the Liberation of Guinea and Cabo Verde. PAIGC. When the hot war of liberation started in 1963, Cabral and the party were prepared in many ways. So here you see the symbol of hot war, a gun. in the picture. The PAIGC did not only carry guns into the interior of Guinea-Bissau in order to fight against the colonial forces. They also carried with them an educational program, a curriculum they had developed together that was African-centered, anti-capitalist curriculum. They also carried with them people who had been already trained, people who were carrying guns, who were soldiers, who had already been trained to be the teachers of the new curriculum. And they carried with them blueprints for schools that people in the communities could build themselves as the land was liberated. I learned all of this from a brilliant young Portuguese scholar of Cabo Verdean descent, whose name is Sonia Vaz Borges, who's doing her PhD in Berlin. And I look forward to the day when we can all read her work. And as is the case with young Portuguese scholars, she is fluent in Portuguese, Creole, French, Spanish, English, and German. So we will all be able to read her work. I tell you these stories in order to impress upon you and get our minds to open up to how complicated and yet inviting the entire terrain, the entire land of mass incarceration is, and how it is possible in developing complex understandings of the phenomenon, not to make the complexity into its own reward, oh, I'm an academic, I told a story hard to follow, but rather, which I do get accused of, but rather to show in the complexity that there are all kinds of ways for people to enter into the work and do it. There's work to be done in rural places, in urban places, in communities where people in prison come from, in communities to which they return. There's work for people in between to do. There's work for people to do in legislatures, appointed, elected officials. There's work for people to do in environmental justice and other kinds of social justice activism. And there's a lot of work growing for people to do connecting these struggles internationally the way liberation struggles on this planet have always been connected internationally in order to succeed. And something I didn't say, I should have said, this is for my parents. I'm happy they live to see me walk across the stage down in New Brunswick to get my PhD. I was 48. Very, yes. Wait a minute. Good. All right, so the title of the talk, after all of that preamble, is Too Soon for Sorry. This excellent image crosshatches a rather familiar image underneath with something atop that you probably recognize but might not know the origin of. So underneath, if you can see, is that image of the Brooks, the slave ship that abolitionists used at the beginning of the 19th century to try to turn people's moral sensibility once and for all against chattel slavery. They focused on the slave trade, and the Brooks, the ship, indicated the conditions under which those captured into slavery were taken from the western coast of Africa to the eastern coast of the Americas. The image that crosshatches the Brooks is a prison that was designed by none other than Thomas Jefferson. Yes, Thomas Jefferson, that Enlightenment guy, was always thinking about more things to do to make society conform to his dream of what freedom was. And his dream of what freedom was included the nightmare of unfreedom, both as a slave owner and as somebody who designed prisons. The artist and designer David Thorne developed this image in 1992, the year my colleague graduated from Rutgers. He designed it because William, middle name Jefferson Clinton, was preparing to apologize for slavery. David Thorne said, "It's too soon for sorry," because of mass incarceration. Not because mass incarceration is slavery, but rather because unfreedom persists. Now I see in the news that William Jefferson Clinton has apologized for his role in mass incarceration. It's still too soon for sorry. While Bill Clinton's middle name, as I said, draws on Jefferson, the designer of these cells, the problem that we face is a problem that cannot be addressed incrementally, even though there's all kinds of work to be done in so many different areas. And I'm going to come back to that in a moment. The problem that we have to address has an entire universe of urgencies that we cannot, as the Chancellor reminded us in her remarks this morning, look away from any longer. Now, you've heard already from the President and from the Chancellor the enormity of the situation of mass incarceration. I call this graph, which I got from a good colleagues at the Sentencing Project, the tsunami. This is the tsunami of mass incarceration. And as you can see, the rate of incarceration, and this is just federal and state prison, it doesn't include jail, I'm going to get there in a minute. The rate of incarceration, federal and state, was not quite flat, but it didn't change very much between 1985 and the mid to late 1970s. You see how kind of flat it was. And then suddenly, boom, it took off. It took off at the same time that the US political economy experienced the organized abandonment, which is the only way to describe how it is that capitalists picked up their factories and took them somewhere else. That is the only way to explain, to describe it. Organized abandonment. They picked up their factories and took them somewhere else. People think the factories went to Mexico and China. Some of them did. They also went into Europe so that the capitalists could benefit from those markets there. They didn't only go to low-wage areas. They went to places where the capitalists felt confident, could project, that they would make the most money. But in making these moves, they busted up unions. And that's something else I'm going to come back to, and I know Heather has a lot to say on that topic. So this particular graph has a little bit of hope at the end, because you see at the very end it starts to go down. Unfortunately, this graph ends in 2012, went back up in 2013. There was a blip up in the rate of incarceration, and the people who accounted for a good deal of that increase were, you think I'm going to say African-American somebody, white women. White women on drug charges. White women on drug charges. So behind the sturdy curtain of racism, which is indisputable in all aspects of mass incarceration, a lot of people who are not black or of color get caught up too. As a result, if you take home no other message from me today, the message you must take home is disproportionality is not the problem. Criminalization is. if there were a move to make mass incarceration more proportional, we would just have more people in prison, not fewer. Not fewer. Not fewer. Okay. The world inmate population rate per 100,000. Now, if you can read this graph, you see, as the president told us this morning, nobody in the world imprisons more people in absolute numbers or as a rate than the United States of America. Not even close. Number two is Russia, not the Soviet Union. We're talking about after communism. The capitalist state of the Russian Federation is number two. South Africa, three. Brazil, four, and so forth. The countries that I put into this graph for your consideration include the group of seven, the G7, the richest countries on the planet, as measured by economic activity, and the BRICS, Brazil, Russia, India, China, and South Africa, the so-called emerging hot economies. They're also big. What we know in general from studying the underlying relationships experienced by people who live in these places, abstracted into these graphs, is the deeper inequality in the country, the more frequently recourse is made to criminalization and incarceration. That's what you see here. You're looking at a graph of inequality. Not unequal criminalization, inequality, period. Full stop. Indeed, we should bear in mind, bless you, we should bear in mind that capitalism requires inequality and racism enshrines it. All right. Now this fantastic and slightly busy, but fantastic pie chart is by my good friend Peter Wagner, who has a small nonprofit called the Prison Policy Institute that's pretty much him and one coworker most of the time. Heather and I are both on the advisory board, and they do the best work. If you're doing research, find them online. They put together summaries of other people's research. They provide links and PDFs for papers and research and reports and so forth. They are excellent. There's hardly anyone who does better fundamental research than these people. So let us look at who's locked up, how many people are locked up, and who holds them in custody. As you can see, in state prisons, 1.359, so 1,360,000 people are in state prisons, all right? Federal prisons, about 211,000. In federal prisons, about half the people are there on drug convictions, drug-related convictions. State prisons is not the case. So everybody thinks it's drugs, and if only drug laws changed people, the number of people in prisons would come down dramatically. That's only for the 211,000 people in federal prison. It's not for most of the people in state prison at all, at all. So that's one thing. The second thing to remember is the president of the United States, whoever it will be, has a lot of power as the most powerful person in the capitalist world. Can send drones to kill people, send military to kill people, can send money to help people. Presidents are very powerful. They are not powerful enough, however, to compel states to change their sentencing law unless the sentencing law is in some way in violation of the Constitution. Right? So, when somebody, a candidate for president says, I'm gonna change mass incarceration by changing this or that or the other law, the only jurisdiction that will be affected by that is federal, not the rest, not the rest of the pie. So don't be beguiled, please. Then up on the top, that big orange slice is local jails. There are about, at any given moment, about 650,000 people in jail. But because jails are, in general, short-term, people are held pending trial, they're held for punishment for a sentence that is a year or less, the number of people who pass through jails on an annual basis is about 11 million. 11 million people churn through the jail system. But at any given moment, you take a snapshot, there's 650,000 people. Now, stop and think. Every time somebody is interrupted in their life and sent to jail, even though they might get out in a few days or a few weeks or a few months, the life has not been waiting on hold for them. It means they lose jobs. It means they lose the place that they're renting. It means they might become ineligible for the job or the place that they're renting, and so on and so forth. Yeah. So that churn indicates the depth of disorder that mass incarceration, including short-term incarceration in jail, produces in everyday life. Okay. Now, one of the things that's very interesting about these statistics is that when you lay them across the various actual jurisdictions, so Essex County or the state of New Jersey, the county of New York, the city of New York, or the state of California, the place I know best, Louisiana, Michigan, you name it, every single jurisdiction can, like athletes in major league sports, claim some statistical uniqueness. So you know how they'll say, some guy will be on bat to bat, and they'll say, he has the highest rate of hitting and getting on base when there are two people out in the bottom of the ninth and he's batting against a 6 foot tall pitcher. Right? You always hear that. The commentators tell you all of these things. Well, the same thing can be said about prisons and jails. So Milwaukee County has the highest rate of incarceration of black men, and Louisiana has the highest rate of incarceration of black men, and other places have the highest rate. And they're all true, but they're true in the way that that batter's, you know, uniqueness is true. It might not mean that much in the aggregate, but it is a way to get people's attention. Now, having said all this about the state of incarceration and who holds whom, oh, I should say one more thing. You see the gray immigrant detention? We were reminded there's an immigrant detention center very close to where we are today. One of my students, Marlene Ramos, is writing her dissertation about it and changes in the Ironbound as well. She's great. Immigration detention is another place where a lot of people churn through. The churn is quite high. The churn is quite high. It's as high as 3.5, maybe almost 4 million people a year. But at any given moment, there are 33,000, maybe 34,000 people locked up. So the snapshot tells you one thing. The churn tells you something else. Now, of all these people locked up, 92%, all of these people, 2.3 million people, 92% are in publicly owned, publicly operated, public facilities. About 8% are in privately managed, in some cases the buildings are privately owned, but rarely, facilities funded by the public dollar, right? So most people, like 92% of 2.3 million, somebody get out your calculator and figure out what that number is, are in public facilities, and about 8% in private. And what this tells us is the privates do not drive the system. If they did, they would have more people in their clutches. They would. Capitalists are not fools. They're terrible in their social relation to us, not as individuals. Some of them are nice, some of them are not, right? But they are willing to accept human sacrifice as the cost of doing business, which I am not. But what privates are parasites on the system. They're parasites on the system. That's what they do. They figure out a way to get a chunk of the market, and they hang on to it as long as they can. Many people having been convinced that privates are the problem, have gone after private prison contractors. And do you know what the outcome has been? In the states in recent years that canceled private prison contracts, the number of people locked up went up. It went up. It didn't go down. So I am in the habit of saying, polemically, that we could cancel all the contracts tomorrow and not one person would go home. Not one person would go home. So one of the candidates for president, I'm not going to name any of them, I don't think. One of the candidates for president said, and I will introduce legislation to end private. It doesn't matter. What matters is that we end criminalization. That's what matters. Indeed, I have started down the path of the next point I wish to make, which is the worrying state of the anti-prison movement today. The delusion about privates is one. There's a lot of money that goes to funding campaigns against privates. And you've probably noticed that students have been convinced to agitate on their campuses to compel the trustees to divest from private prisons. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. And it makes me very upset that young people's good faith is thus abused. It makes me very upset. If, however, the young people who pursue the campaign to divest from private prisons continue down the path to close public prisons, then I will be less upset. Another worrying state of anti-prison movement is the belief that somehow if we get the non-serious, non-violent, non-sexual offenders out, that the number of people is going to go down significantly. It's not. We have to actually start at the big sentences and say, what about these sentences? Does life without parole ever make sense? Elsewhere in the world, there are no life sentences. Right? There are no life sentences. Does 25 years without parole make sense? No. So we start with the most extreme sentences, and yes, I'm talking about the people who kill people, and work our way back. And indeed, one thing I've learned in doing international comparative research, and I know Khalil has done a bit of this too, is I've learned that where life is precious, life is precious. And that means where the state, whatever it is, New Jersey, Essex County, the United States, New York, where the state models for the people that life is precious, the people are less likely to solve problems by harming each other, right? So it's not about diversity, it's not about, by harming each other. This is what I've learned. Okay. Another worrying state of the anti-prison movement, another issue that has concerned me quite a bit is the delusion that the reason there are so many people in prison is so that their labor can be exploited by those capitalists I've been talking about. Well, on the one hand, it makes perfect sense to think that somebody whose job it is to reduce the cost of doing business would roll in to a prison or jail to get free or nearly free labor. The fact is, they don't. There are about 4,400 licensed individuals who are currently incarcerated for whom private contractors are licensed to use their labor. 4,400. Now remember, the number is 2.3 million. The rest of the people who do work in prison are working for the prison, mostly doing what we call reproductive labor, cooking and cleaning. Right? Reproductive labor, cooking and cleaning. And then some work in some version of a state-run prison industry authority or do clean up outdoors, clean along the highway, you know what I'm talking about. That's what they do. Now, I'm perfectly happy to agitate for such people to be paid prevailing wage for their work, that they be paid exactly what somebody would be paid outside. But the point is, they're not working for any external capitalist who, by the way, does not go after that labor that seems so amazingly available and amazingly cheap, because for capitalism, time is money, right? You gotta turn it. And therefore, if the product, whatever it is, cannot come out of the factory on time in the right quantity and quality, there's no profit. That's why they don't go in. States that have tried to induce private firms to come in usually have to subsidize that inducement. What does that tell you? It doesn't work. The final thing that I want to say about the worrying state of anti-prison movement, I have a lot more to say, it's just the final thing of this section, has to do with the giddiness that many people express over the so-called bipartisan consensus on criminal justice reform. All you have to do is read who is funding this to know there's something wrong, something significantly wrong with this consensus. The Koch brothers from Wisconsin, who have made it their life's work to squeeze every possible profit dollar out of the hides of their workers and to bust public unions to make sure that workers even in the public sector will accept poverty wages to have a job, are major funders of this bipartisan consensus. So then we have to say, well, what do they want? Do they have a wake-up moment? Somebody go to, you know, their place of worship and see the light? Well, I think there are a couple of things going on. The first is, these guys are laying around a lot of money, and so they get legitimized by already existing social justice activist organizations agreeing to hold hands with them. It's one thing. But two, what the Koch brothers, I think, are up to is to use this consensus and the scant resources that they will put into communities like Newark that have need of great resources to say, all right, here's a few dollars to enhance your reentry program. But a condition of the gift is this reentry program has got to be run by a not-for-profit with no organized union organized workers. It's got to be run more or less like a charter school with no union organized teachers. This is where I think it's going. I also have been told by my good friend Marie Gottschalk, who I wish were here today with us on the panel, is that she thinks as well that Koch and the Koch brothers and their community of capitalists are looking at what the investment or sales opportunities are going to be in the area of non-carceral surveillance and, you know, home detention, ankle bracelets, that kind of thing. All right. I'm also worried, sharing all of my worries with you, about the militarization of the police rather than the police. I'm happy for the focus on the police, because as my friend and colleague Naomi Murakawa says, you know, you can't have mass incarceration without the shovel, which is to say the people who send the people into the system who are the first contact for criminalization, the police. But the police, as the shovel of the system, have got to be understood as more than the big, flashy, tanks and so forth. So this is an LAPD helicopter. It's kind of iconic. Los Angeles Police Department, for a very long time, put more money into capital, which is to say machinery, than into labor, which is to say uniform police, because Los Angeles is the kind of city that can be looked over and looked at effectively from a bird. Its skyline is fairly low, its density is not very high, it's easy to see, there are alleys between streets and so forth, it's kind of a place that's easy to see. So this use of helicopters and other kinds of military-style equipment by police in Los Angeles for a very long time should make us pause when we ask that, for example, the U.S. Department of Justice intervene in the allocation of surplus military equipment to local police. Because the question is, even if all of the tanks that local police have gotten, is there one here in Newark? Does Newark have a tank? Good. All right. Even if all those tanks are scrapped and all the grenade launchers are scrapped and so on and so forth, probably won't have any effect on police killings. Well, why? Because police don't kill people with tanks. They use standard issue weapons, guns and batons, and they weaponize ordinary things, their hands, their elbows, their vans. That's how they kill. So the problem is not with the militarization of the police in terms of equipment, it's the police. And perhaps we can add, and their military attitude toward the people who they are supposed to protect and serve. Indeed, when police departments get military surplus, the manufacturer of the tank or the grenade launcher or the whatever doesn't get paid again. They already got paid by the Pentagon. The Pentagon gets some money that's kind of traded back and forth. It's very shell game, exchange of revenue. They don't get paid again, but many of the reforms that, for example, Campaign Zero support will increase the market for things made by these same contractors. As I said in discussing the Koch brothers earlier, body cams and ankle bracelets and so forth. So we're not weakening the military police relationship. Indeed, we should also be mindful of the fact that the relationship between military and the police is long-standing in this country. It goes back to, for example, the plantation South. It goes back to, for example, ports and trade, including here in New Jersey and New York. This I'm talking about the 18th century, not the 20th century. It goes back to the conquest of the West and genocide. It goes back to U.S. imperial wars and trade expansion in the 19th and into the early 20th century. In all of these cases, as a number of scholars have shown, there's a back and forth, not only between police and military, but also between places. So that U.S. police went to the Philippines, perfected certain kinds of activities in policing, brought them back to the U.S. Or people from Latin America came to the U.S., learned certain techniques in policing, took them back to Latin America, and so forth. Right? There are these circulations and connections as well. So I'm going to talk about a couple of cases now and then eventually wind up. So, many people imagine that the solution to police brutality and police excesses is something called community policing. Many people believe it. I'm thinking maybe not here, because this is a city with a civilian police review board. So that is a great thing. And I'm honored to be speaking in a city with such a board. So we know from the work of Tony Platt and Paul Tagaki and so on and others that the United States, especially places like Los Angeles, rolled out community policing in the wake of many of the urban uprisings that characterized the 1960s, right? So 63, 64, 65, 66, 67, 68, every year had uprisings. These were my high school years. So I graduated in high school in 68, the day Bobby Kennedy was assassinated. It's the day I graduated from high school. And 2 months earlier to the day was the day Martin Luther King Jr. was assassinated, my last 2 months of high school. So at the time, this is the late 60s, early 70s, that the US was still deeply involved in the losing fight for what they called hearts and minds in Vietnam, the military rolled out a form of counterinsurgency called pacification that resulted in some high profile and many still yet to be revealed slaughters of people in communities in Vietnam, the forced relocation of people from their homes to what were called strategic hamlets, and so forth. At the same time, in places like Los Angeles, and doubtless here in Newark, in Detroit, and other cities, community policing unrolled to achieve similar goals, to pacify communities, to figure out how to make communities, not enable them to police themselves, but make them collaborators with the police departments, who did not let up on their brutality, but wanted to make sure they suppressed outrage expressed in the form of riots to that brutality. So Vietnam and domestic pacification were two sides of the same counterinsurgency coin in the 60s and early 70s. And this slide is to exemplify the kinds of people who were rising up and organizing. So the two people on the left, some of you might recognize them, yes? John Huggins and Bunchy Carter, very famous. They were leadership of the Los Angeles chapter of the Black Panther Party for Self-Defense. They were assassinated in a hit that was organized by COINTELPRO, this is all documented, on January the 17th, 1970. Johnny was my cousin, his mother and I, my mother were sisters. He developed his radical analysis while serving in the Navy in the Gulf of Tonkin in Vietnam. Bunchy Carter, who was from Los Angeles, John's from New Haven like me, Bunchy Carter, who was from Los Angeles, developed his analysis in another kind of total institution. So while the military is one, prison is another. He had spent time in prison, and while in prison, in the days when prisoners had libraries and they could have study groups, he read and he studied, and he came out ready to use his ingenuity and energy to change Los Angeles rather than to fight in the streets, right? So the two of them were assassinated at UCLA, where they were students. And what they were doing as students the day they were killed was arguing with other students over curriculum. Curriculum. Can I say that again? Curriculum. They were arguing about what a Black Studies program should be. Should it be compensatory? Black people did what white people did? Or should it be oppositional? There is a way that we can make freedom, as the chancellor said. And if we make our freedom, other people will be free too. That's completely different from Black people did what white people did, right? Completely different. And it was in that context they were killed. They were killed in Campbell Hall. My cousin bled to death on the floor of the basement there. At the same time, and shortly thereafter, students in East LA, which is the capital of Mexican American California, walked out of school in protest of their lousy curriculum in the public schools, and walked out in protest of the Vietnam War, which was for the guys the only way that they could see to make a path to college. And others, right? So people were fighting for equality of opportunity in education, but they were also fighting for a different kind of outcome, right? A different kind of knowledge. And I came to Rutgers because I thought that I would get that different kind of knowledge. And here I am. This is what Rutgers does. So at this time then, we have community policing rolls out, pacification of communities most likely to be the places where uprisings might happen, East LA, South Central LA, and so forth. and also SWAT, Special Weapons and Tactics Team, developed by Los Angeles Police Department, and the first time they ever used it, ever, in history, was December of the same year that John and Bunche were assassinated. Right? They, LAPD, rolled on the headquarters of the Black Panther Party for Self-Defense at the corner of 41st Street and Central Avenue. It was the first time SWAT ever was used. Right? So we see where I'm going with this. Now, that was then, this is now. The current community policing is more like, and it's hard to tell which came first, the model of military humanitarianism that has unrolled in Afghanistan and Iraq in recent years. That is to say, the soldiers in those places go around more or less as diplomats in camouflage, dispensing benefits, starting with the elder women in the communities, the grandmothers, to try to develop collaboration so that people will point the finger at other people in their community for the benefit of the military. Same in community policing and the community safety project in Los Angeles. In the public housing projects where the community safety project has unrolled, grandmothers, police, benefits like tutoring and bifocals and diabetes screening, all good things that all poor people need. But these poor people get it only to the extent that they are willing to collaborate with the police against their neighbors. And I don't mean to say there aren't times when people want their neighbors to go away. It does happen. But this is a different kind of relationship. Now, in the few minutes that I have left, which is far fewer than I thought, I want to talk a bit more expansively about history, because I think this history matters. Okay. We've been talking about the military, which means we've been talking to some degree about the Pentagon. And if we study the rise of the Pentagon, we can see something about the ways that institutions, police, education, military, social welfare, and so forth, compete with each other and absorb each other's missions and structures. This is what I want to do for this next little bit. So, at a time when the US state at all levels was growing, I mean openly growing, rather than covertly growing, which is the way it does now. The Department of War, at the end of World War II, faced an existential dilemma that it faced at the end of every war. The Department of War used to shrink at the end of every war. Right? The US is so often at war, it's hard to tell, but it's true that it used to shrink. But at the end of the Second World War, the Department of War's military elites and their industrial and political allies modeled a new growth plan on the fiscal and bureaucratic structures that were developed for the New Deal, right? So developed for the New Deal was a way to gather resources, money resources, in order to transfer that into jobs programs and the Works Progress Administration and the Parks and Art Administration and so forth, or Social Security, to provide a guaranteed benefit for working people once they could no longer work. So the Department of War looked at those structures that were developed for social welfare benefits, absorbed the fiscal capacities and absorbed the bureaucratic capacities. This is how we'll make it work. And emerged at the end as the Pentagon. It had never existed before. It's so normal to us. It hadn't existed before. It's a few years before I was born. So they did that. That's the how, fiscal and bureaucratic. But why? It was to fight communism, which is to say they're the Pentagon for capitalism, and to fight, be prepared for the decolonial wars that were coming. And they were coming indeed. So what happened when the Pentagon became the Pentagon? What did it do in the land? There were changes in land use policy. it's the only industrial policy the United States has ever had, has been the war policy. It employed hundreds and hundreds of thousands of uniformed and civilian personnel from then till now. There are probably people in this room who either have been or are currently employed by the Pentagon. It churned trillions of dollars through think tanks and universities. It promoted mass education post-secondary, right? National Defense Education Act. Right? This is all out of the Pentagon. It also was the cause of one of the most massive population transfers ever in the history of this country. As the gun belt rose, the people who moved into the South and along that star-spangled curve on the cover of that book, Markison used to be a professor here at Rutgers, people moved into that area, other people moved out. There was a huge displacement. So not only did people move in, people moved out. Completely changed the landscape and the land use in the United States. And all of that adds up to the military-industrial complex, all of these things. The local boosters who wanted these things, the uniformed civilian personnel, the thinkers, the planners, the market public relations people, and so forth. That is the military-industrial complex. And they did all of this in order to perfect industrialized killing, in order to perfect the capacity to kill people with a minimal use of human brain and muscle. They also developed the Sun Belt. They developed the Sun Belt, which became the major political region producing Presidents Johnson, Nixon, Carter, Reagan, Bush, Clinton, Bush. They rule this country. Those presidents began to dismantle the weak but relatively effective welfare state, putting in place inducements to contain resistance to austerity through criminalization. That's the outcome of the military-industrial complex. As a result, when my colleagues and I, comrades and I, founded Critical Resistance in 1998 and tried to popularize a term coined by Mike Davis, prison-industrial complex, this was the size of our thinking. This was the size of our thinking. Land use, people transfer, think tanks, universities, all of those things. And we know, for example, that here at Rutgers University, criminal justice grew as a major. I got my degree at Livingston College. Criminal justice wasn't even there in Lucy Stonehall when I was a student. So as you know, in 1961, the Alabama Freedom Riders met with brutal suppression by the Alabama Ku Klux Klan. And in a number of places where the Freedom Rider buses arrived, the Klan showed up to beat the riders and burn the buses. Fisk students in Nashville, Tennessee, who were already veterans of the lunch counter sit-ins and had already been trained in nonviolent confrontation, which isn't to say pacifism, but in how to not get hurt too badly when you don't have enough force to hurt the other guy, right? Passive resistance. Saw that many of the Freedom Riders who had come from Washington, D.C., actually gathered from around the country, were too terrified to continue. So the Fisk students, student activists, came and said, we're going to continue this ride. So they got into buses, new buses, the ones that weren't burned, and continued into Mississippi, where Ross Barnett changed the plot. Ross Barnett, who was then the governor of Mississippi, told the Klan to stay home. He said, I got this. I'm going to use the laws of Mississippi, including the segregation laws of Mississippi, to lock these people up. And he did. He bragged about it in an interview a few years later. He locked them up in the sheriff's jail, and when the sheriff's jail ran out of space, he put them in the chicken coops down at the fairground, and when the chicken coops were full, he put them at Parchment Farm, the notorious Parchment Farm. So we've heard from the point of view of those who were locked up what their experience was inside. But here's what I'd like to bring to your attention today. Not only did Ross Barnett's government in Jackson, Mississippi, do those things to the Freedom Riders, it did other things as well during the same legislative year. It changed the laws of the state to a right-to-work state thereby making it impossible for any union to demand union membership on the part of any people the union might organize. It cut taxes and became a business-friendly state. In order, as other low-wage states in the United States have been doing since 1940, to attract industry from high-wage, highly organized states to the Magnolia State. And also, because Barnett used legal criminalization rather than the extra-legal, although state-sanctioned mob violence of the Klan, he made nice with the Kennedy administration so that when those gun belt dollars started flowing south, some of them would stick in Mississippi. Indeed, today, in 2016, where black farmers are fighting against dispossession from their land grab after land grab, one of the hot spots in Mississippi is right next to one of the bases where Ross Barnett's, oh, I'll just go all legal here, criminalization project produced the opportunity for the military to come in and put a lot of money. And as you could see here, Mississippi is still doing pretty well with military personnel. All right. So the reason to insist on the complexity of the prison industrial complex is to reveal how many places it can be attacked. Just as the reason to dispel myths is to avoid wasting people's good energy and goodwill. Harriet Tubman and Amilcar Cabral understood this, as did the Black Party, Panther Party for Self-Defense. Can't tell you about those people. As have people who have come out to meetings around the US where we have tried to help stop a jail or prison or the hiring of more police. People show up committed to environmental justice and embrace anti-prison and anti-policing solutions. People show up committed to helping at-risk kids stay in school in order to graduate and perhaps get to college, and wind up embracing reducing the number of police. I don't mean training the police, reducing the number of police, and so forth. As have public sector workers, including public sector workers who work in prisons, who, other than prison guards, can do what they do anywhere. A locksmith is a locksmith, a secretary is a secretary, a teacher is a teacher, a janitor is a janitor. And they understand that prison is not the horizon of their potential ability to work and be productive in this world. And guards can be retrained. So Cabral reminded us, he taught us over and over again, to claim no easy victories. And I worry very much that Campaign Zero and some of the proposals that have circulated, including the divest from prison, private prisons, are very easy victories. They make splashy headlines, but they don't change anybody's life. And Harriet Tubman made clear how seizing freedom is a means to try and try again, always means to try and try again. We learned that we make the road by walking. These are Eric Garner's eyes. So let's get going. Thank you.